Is it back? Is it working well this time? Did it work? Did it go? I can't even see my preview yet, so I don't know. All right, looks pretty good to me now. Let me know if it works for you guys. Oh yeah. Twitch ads. Gotta wait for a Twitch ad. I wish I could turn those off. Cool. So it looks like the audio might be better. I wish when I say off, I mean I wish I could turn them off on my stream. You know, like YouTube, you sort of control that. You know, at least you used to sometimes, mostly. I don't know. Wish you could turn that off. Anyway, if we're better, let me get started. So I said I would work on editing text in the gap buffer, but before I can actually do that, there's one little thing. I'm getting ready to release a new 4coder build. So the cat's out of the bag. There'll be one sometime, hopefully in the next couple days. To get that ready, I've been doing some things, and I discovered that all of the stuff I've been working on, I ended up breaking one of the left to right seeks, and there might be others that are broken too. I didn't check, but I want to make sure those are working before I get back to the buffer experiment so that I can get a 4coder build out. So, just real quick, what I want to work on is seek. Yeah, there's different left and right, so I'm gonna start by looking at rights, and one of them at least I know is totally broken. Seek token right, is this one? This looks like it should work fine, because seek token right. We're just finding the position and setting it, sure. This one, while the scalpel is off, it's included, so. I could test that one, but I think it must be correct because it's at least compiling and I haven't changed it. Buffer seek whitespace left works the same. Seek token left works the same. So, yeah, that one should work. Alphanumeric right and alphanumeric left I have already done abstract streams for, so it's just these ones are really the only ones that I noticed earlier weren't working and I'd like to get them working. So, seeking alphanumeric or camel right and left. Let's see if I can stream these, and then we can get to gap buffer stuff. So I need to find a good spot to put this. Left. Okay, seek alphanumeric left. After that seems like a good place for alphanumeric or camel, which it's a little bit involved, maybe, but not terrible. I think now that I have it worked out in the. I found a good way to do this is first work it out without streaming on a golden array. Just figure out how to get something to work with the on top of a golden array, and then streaming it's usually pretty easy after that. Buffer seek alpha numeric or camel right. There we go. This needs a buffer type. And a position. And now this one over here can just work by instead of this, which is no longer really the way things work, I can just do. Well, how does this work? It and position, alphanumeric position, is I just seek the right and find an alphanumeric position. Then it looks like I start from the position where I was at plus a little bit. I'm sure there's a valid reason for why that makes sense, like trying to get past a certain number of characters that would otherwise stop you. Seek to the right a second time. Don't go all the way, just stop once you get to the alphanumeric position. And if the character is upper and the previous character is lower, then break and stop right there. So yeah, that seems like something I can do with the stream pretty straightforwardly. in a pretty straightforward fashion. So to do that, I need pretty much what I always need. I need a forward loop and some other things. I'll need an alphanumeric position, and then what I can do is just say call my normal alphanumeric seek alphanumeric right on the buffer in the position, and that will get my alphanumeric position one to the right of where I wherever I am. Then we want to get up. Whoops, this should go up here. Ch and previous ch, and before the loop starts. Okay, so the next thing I need to do is initialize the loop. Stringify loop. I pass it the buffer, the position where I want to start, the place where I want to end, and a page size. So I'm going to need a size there, and to compute that, I can just do size equals buffer size on the buffer. Stringify loop, right, and then start the stream loop, which looks something like this in this case. You'll notice that something I decided to do here, well, I don't really need to describe it, you're an intelligent audience, but I describe it for myself's sake. So I didn't actually put the loop initializer right here, where I could have, where I often do, even though I'm only doing one of these loops, because I want to do something to initialize the loop that requires me to have a little bit of information about the data up front. So, position plus one. So that's a little bit tricky because there's the remote chance that the position that the first page I got is only contains one character. Like if I have a gap buffer and I want to start and I happen to choose to start right before the gap, I have one character in the first chunk. So I have to be a little smart about this. I can't just say position plus one on the data. I need to sort of do the iteration across correctly. So what that means is something like set that up, get the data, which is the loop data minus the absolute position as I often have written around here, and get the end position, which is the loop size plus the absolute position. Alright. And then for it's interesting. What do I need to do here? Well, basically, I'm trying to get this. This is trying to get this whole previous character, next character loop going. I think that's plus two because I've already set previous character, and camel position wants to start at the character after that, and the previous character was set one after the starting position, so that it doesn't get stuck on itself, probably. So, what maybe I want to do is set these both to zero for now, and then when a loop starts, the first thing I do is that the current character equals, so this right here can just go inside there like I'd prefer for it to. Whoops. And then you, okay, there we go. And then while the position is still less than end, we do the second step of the structure I've been using. All right, so that sets up the stream in the nice familiar way. I set the character like so. At the end, I set the previous character like so. And then what I'll do is I'll say if the previous character does not equal 0, we'll do the rest of the work. That way it skips that on the first step. It's a little bit of an annoying way to do it. But the alternative is to like write a for like to write all of this in a way that would kind of annoy me. I think this is good enough for now to satisfy me. So, if the character is not 0, the previous character that is, then do what we would normally do right here. Check it and the current character for upper lowerness. Now, the only catch to this is that there's actually a null in the buffer for some reason, which is technically allowed. Although, you know, it's not really a great situation. It's technically allowed. This would have a bug. So maybe my hands are tied and I have to do the annoying thing I was trying to avoid, now that I think about it. So, okay. What I'll do is we do this, and well, one thing I could do is I could start this at position plus 1. And technically, I don't want to go all the way to the end. I want to stop at the position of the alphanumeric seek ended. Alright, so that's a little better. And then the next thing I want to do is set my previous character to equal data 0 after this has been done. And then increment my position 1. And then maybe what I can do is just assume that, like, if I start that, it'll check good, it will see that it's good, it won't do the next right away. Right. So, if, the only thing I have to do is right here check that it was good, since I don't have the for loop doing that for me like I usually do. So there we go, we're still checking if the stream is good, and then if it is, I do some work that is specific to the first step, and then after that, check if the stream is still good, compute end in data a second time, which is what can you do? Well, what I can do is that, actually, because I already put 0 there, because I was thinking, right, so I'll just not shift the loop data around for that case. It'll come in here, then it'll shift stuff around for the data to line up, and then it says, okay, if position is less than end, which is now the same as this because I set my end to be the AN position, and the plus plus is the same, setting the character, and then finally we can do if is upper character and is lower the previous character, then we can break out. But as usual, that won't work because of the fact that I can't break out of a doubly nested for loop, so I'm going to do a goto instead, and that goto label is quite long, as are many of my go-to labels. And finally, I return the position, except the position maybe isn't right. No, it is, because we'll break out if we find a spot that's basically, that's what's going on right here, and this just returns camel position tech, like basically is the sense of this code. Oops, I never did my tweet. Let me get this out here real quick. All right. Get all of this out of the way. All right. So, that seems pretty solid now. I'm feeling pretty good about that one. So, do what I always do. Seek alphanumeric. Nope. Or camel, right? File buffer. Cursor position, cursor move to the position. All right. So that's seeking to the right. How similar is seeking to the left? It doesn't and position. It starts one less than there. So this one, I wouldn't have the plus one. I would just leave it as it was. While I'm still greater than that position, I would back up. Yeah, okay, so I can say that this is going to be pretty similar, so I can comfortably do a copy-paste and then change some key things. So it's a backify loop. I want to do seek left here. I want to do position here for the backify loop. I want to check if backify is good, and I want to do backify good next for the loop. I want my position to go backwards one. I still store the previous character. Good. I still do is upper and is lower. This should say left, and this should say left. This up here should be a backed up, and this is position is greater than end instead of less than. The loop is a little different now, like so. Data position if is upper and okay, looks pretty good. So what I could do to be more abstract in the future, to be like a better structure here, is that I basically want to do a seek camel that's just generic, that doesn't tie itself to seeking alphanumeric, and you'd specify position as well as the, you know, and position, and you'd pass those in. So I'm going to say that screw what I already wrote. Let's do it that way, because I've just described it, and now that I see it, I like it better. It's more general. Smaller. So, let's do it. There we go. And then you don't need to do that explicitly. It's being done for you. I need to make the same changes up here on this one. And then this just maybe wants to assert something, which is that, a couple things, actually. It's going to want to assert that the position is less than the and position, and that the and position is less than the size. Which doesn't usually have to deal with, but I don't usually have an end position that can potentially go outside of the size, so that seems like a smart thing to do in this case. And this one will be similar. I want to make sure that the and position goes there, and that the zero is less than or equal to the and position. So we can definitely feel pretty good about that. The only other thing left to do is I need to go into the shared portion. And I need a few more character helper functions. which I can get from the string part of 4CPP. And convert into this style. So we just need you. And you. Very good. Very good. What do we got here? Redefinition, of course we have that. Because I didn't think of it. Right, and I need to rewrite this in terms of the generically programmed stream version now. Alphanumeric. This should be alphanumeric, right? I see. Okay. That is the label from earlier. Grab my position. Grab the and position. And then do the move. Alright, just to satisfy these warnings, and I guess potentially skip branching twice when you only need to branch once, we'll do that. Let me get my debugger on this screen. Alright. So this is running. Oops, I still got a breakpoint set. This is running Golden Array. I should be able to seek to alphanumerics, which I don't know if I have a good example of an alphanumeric sitting around. Because I separate most things by underscores. Or I mean camel case is what I need. Well, one thing I need to test is, does it do, okay, so does that correctly, which means it doesn't stop at every capital letter in an all caps word, which is good news. But how do I know it's not just stopping at alphanumeric without a camel case test? Where do I have, if I have a, like, array count. There's one, okay. There we go, so you can see that stops at camel case. So you can do stuff like that. Alright, cool. Okay, so we got that done. Let me also try actually doing the same thing with the gap buffer, which means activating the power of the scalpel. Uh-oh. Huh, okay, maybe I didn't ever test this case. I might have screwed up on a previous push to the Git repository. If that's the case, buffer stringify loop. That should be stringify type. Invert batch. Right, you don't have this concept right now, so turn on the scalpel for this code. All right, same code, just no syntax highlighting yet. Connor asks how long I've been going, and then he manages to post blankness. Oh, there it is. It looked like you posted like an empty message somehow. But now I just see that it's a messed up P face. Anyway, I've been going for about 30 minutes. I'll probably go for another hour and a half. Yeah, the camel case motion idea, I just got it because I was thinking, sometimes I do like motion here, for example, is not using it, which is weird. Oh, that's because it's using. Okay, so I have to go just switch. It's just stopping at white space right now because that's how it's bound. I should turn off the. I should un like clear out my super DLL now so that it doesn't pick that up and use it. But, sometimes I'll have like partition cursor and then I'll go, oh, I don't want the partition cursor, and I'll be like right here and then I can go to the end. And when I'm not skipping by white space, but I'm skipping by like alphanumeric, I can do that. And then there was once in a while I would have a camel case without underscores between them, and I realized that maybe sometimes you, if your naming scheme is like similar to mine, but you don't do underscores, you just do camel case, then maybe you'd like to be able to do the same things I do, just without having to put the underscores in. So I made that. It's pretty. I haven't seen something like that, so that's one of those nice little things that I came upon. So let me clear out the super and see if I can set this up to test stopping at camel case real quick. Let me get this on screen just in case anyone wants to see me typing in commands. And then if we do that, it should use my hard-coded binds, so then I can make sure that my hard-coded binds are using camel case. All right, seek white space right. Yes, let's do seek alphanumeric or can't. Oh, only problem that I always have to deal with is that one. I don't have, I have, the names are like handled by a macro so that the name finder doesn't actually know they exist. It's kind of annoying. It's what you get when your editor is not understanding the code properly and taking advantage. All right. So now I should be stopping alphanumerically, which to test will be kind of hard because last time I did a seek to find array count, but I don't have seeking in this yet, this gap buffer. So it's a little bit hard. It's also some kind of bug that I get where, like, the control key starts getting weirdly weird. Alright, anyway, let me just keep. Like, right now I'm hitting control right. Is that. Yeah, that seems like the control key bug, not the. Well, I don't know. Seems like it won't seek to the right from that position, like when there's an empty line, which is maybe not so good. Because there it'll seek right all I want it to, and I can just keep seeking right forever. But if I happen to land on an empty line. Okay, so if it's got spaces, it doesn't care. It's just the new line character that's tripping it up, causing it not to seek to the right. So I should look into that. Let me see if I can find that array count first. Might miss it since I'm going pretty fast here. Let me try. No camel case there. I don't know what I'm doing. I'll just kill this file, open up a small test file, and do some camel case in there. Oh, I can't write. Oh, there's already camel case in here. That's good. Okay, so it looks like it's working for the gap buffer, but I want to figure out why it messes up, and I can see left from those empty lines. I wonder if I can see left from here. I can see left from there, I can see left from there. Okay, so I can always seek left. It's just seeking right from a new line that is surrounded by other new lines, maybe is a problem. Well, I guess that's only two new lines in a row. But anyway, let's see what that might be. Camel right. There we go. Let's see. It will have found that the next alphanumeric position is the like the I of the internal. Like if I'm right here and I hit control right, what I'd want it to do is it steps forward one position. It saves the previous character, steps forward one position. Oh, you know what? I should step forward two positions, because right here I've already stepped forward one position. So what I should really do is plus plus the position right away. And do that. And then what I can do is say right here at the end, if the position, or actually this would just be a matter of right at the beginning, if the position is less than the and position still after that first step. Otherwise, the position equals the and position. Right? Okay, so that's working better. I can seek to where I want to seek now. Right, so let's get to making edits in this, because I keep trying to make edits and they don't work. So it's time that I can replace a range of text. Once I've got replace range, most of the text editing just works. Or at least all the basic stuff. So I need to pull up the gap buffer, and I'm going to pull up the golden array, because this is not going to have anything to do with abstract streams for a little while now. Replace range. What is the interface to that? I want the interface to stay the same. So this is backify next, I assume? Yes. All right, great. So everything kind of laid itself out in the same way, which is nice. Place range. I want it to have the same signature, only it's a gap buffer now. Right, so what's that gonna take? I have a start and an end of where I want to do the replace. Where the replace should happen, the string that I want to put in, how long that is, and then the shift amount. I believe I have to calculate the shift amount just right up front, and that's what happens there. So I can just throw that in. That's like length minus end minus start. There we go. So now with the gap buffer, the idea is, oops, I haven't pre-thought about this at all, so let me think. The idea is you have this gap, and so basically, as long as this range is not totally contained within one of the chunks, you can do the edit, is what's actually important. Let me pull up Mischief real quick, just to draw the picture that I'm thinking of and see if there's any problems, and to let you know what I'm saying, because it might be hard to to follow. So you have some text, and then we'll depict a gap like, I don't know, this. Then I have some empty space, and then I have more text, right? And my thinking is, if the replace range, is like, if it's an insert for a character, the replace range is two ticks right on top of each other. If they're here, for example, it's fine. If they're anywhere else, it's not fine. So that's one thing we want to achieve, is that it takes advantage of the gap if we do an insert right there at the character after that. But also, if I'm going to do replace ranges generically, if I replace a range like this range, right? So this from this character here to this character here, I want to do a replace, for example. Or, if it's this character here, so the start of the buffer to this character here, I want to do a replace. Or if it's this character here to this character here, all of these should be able to take advantage of the gap and not move anything around, because all of them just involve remove like changing the size of this to like become smaller, or changing the size of this to become smaller, and then putting some text in the gap afterwards, right? The only time we have to move the gap first is when the range is totally contained in this chunk, or it's totally contained in this chunk. So that's kind of interesting. That's easy to check for. So maybe what we want to do is say always first move the gap so that it's in the right position. Look at the range. If it's totally contained in one of the chunks, move the extra chunk, the extra part from that chunk, to the other end of the gap, and then you're all free to do the replace. So then after that, you'll be in a situation where your gap is in the right position and you just do the same thing you always do. So first, check if you need to do a thing. If not, you just go straight to the edit. Otherwise, if you need to do the thing, you move it and then your gap is ready to go. That's an awesome arrow, Alan. And then once your gap is ready to go, you pretend like your gap was always ready to go. So it's pretty good. The only other thing to think about maybe is, it was there for a second. I've lost it. Oh, the size of this. The size has to change. So if the gap ever is smaller than the shift amount, basically, right? The shift amount is how much in the golden array. The shift amount is how much the thing is going to grow or shrink. It's zero if the thing if the buffer doesn't change at all. It grows if you have inserted characters or replaced more, or you inserted more than you replaced, and it shrinks if you remove more than you insert, right? So as long as that shift amount can be contained inside your gap, you don't need to grow. But if you need to grow, then we can do what we did over here, basically, which is return how much you need to grow by, or yeah, how what's your new size, what the minimal size is that would contain this new buffer value. So to do that sort of stuff, I'm gonna need a result at least. And after this, I'll just check if the shift amount plus the size is le I don't need those plus ones anymore because I'm not following that rule. So I'm gonna actually start ignoring that, and maybe I'll say over here we should take that out just to start not doing that. But of course, over here, calculating the size is a little bit less straightforward, so I will use the buffer size function for it. And just because there's like a standard way to do it, I guess I should do it on this side too. Who knows? Maybe we can start moving towards a situation where the memory handling is actually abstract and only the replace itself isn't. That might be neat. Haha! Yes. I've gotten my first spam, so let me see here. Ooh, I can't quite tell what that says. Let me try clicking on it again now that it's there. We go. There we go. Okay. And while I'm at it, we're going to have to, if I click this thing that says op user, does that make you a moderator? Is that what that does? I'm gonna say so. Congratulations to the new moderator of the channel, Mr. Miblo. May you have a long and bountiful reign over the spam bots that have finally found my channel. Alright, so if that is going to fit, then do the thing. Otherwise, you need to say, yo, yo, bro. I need more space. And then you return that. Okay, so we've got over here an example of how the golden array does its work. So what I was saying before now applies. We need to take the start and end and see if the start and end are completely contained within one of those. So what does that mean? Well, first of all, we might add to all of these that we expect the start to be less than the end. Right? And we might then be able to conclude if start is less than end, and we might also throw in there some other nice things that would just be nice to have, such as 0 being less than or equal to the starting position, and that the ending position is less than or equal to the size, because it's an exclusive bound, so it can be equal to the size, and we maybe want those on both ends, so actually it's more like that. And now, and you can see I'm already looking at something where maybe I can abstract out the memory stuff more. The memory checks can be an abstract part, so you can have just a direct do the edit call for when you know the memory is good enough, and then a memory safe call that is abstract and goes to the non-memory safe call if it can, and ask for more if it can't. So that's a possibility. Not too excited about that just yet. What I'm more excited about is now that we know if we are asserting these things, then we can say, all right, end, are you less than, strictly less than, the size 1, the size of chunk 1? Or, start, are you strictly greater than the size of chunk 1, or equal to, no, strictly greater than the size of, there we go. So if either of those things are true, if end is strictly less than the size of 1, then that means we're not, then the replace is totally within the bounds of the left-hand chunk. And if start is greater than size 1, then the bounds are totally to the right-hand side of the gap, right? So we have to move the gap to get the insert to work. And let's see. And because of the asserts up top, we know that, like, you know, the start and the end come in order, so checking that the end is less than already also checks that the start is less than, right? We've got that nice sort of property there. So, so we need to move the thing from one end of the buffer to the other. So really, probably what I want to do, actually thinking this through a little bit more, is say, look, do I need to move the buffer left, or do the gap left, or do I need to move it right? So those are two kind of separate issues, whether which direction I'm moving the buffer or the gap. And to do that, what I want to do is, well, in this case, end is less than the chunk, is less than the gap, so I have to take the chunk from after end to size 1 and put that on the other side of the gap and then change the sizes. So that's like a mem. We can do copy because we should be able to guarantee that those don't overlap at all, which is nice. And wait, can we? No. I take that back. That's just totally wrong because the chunk could be humongous and the gap smaller than the chunk we're moving, so they could overlap. So there we go. And I probably want, now that I'm seeing how this shakes out, a data pointer so that I can do that. Now the destination, I don't know where that is yet, so I'll just, like, I don't know, I'll put an unknown in there, and then the data is end, and it starts at end right now, and I want to take the thing that's the remainder of size one after taking off the end, right? So that's the part that needs moving. And now it's just where do I put that? And the answer is going to be I want to take like size one and the gap size and add them together. And that would give me the end position of the gap. And then I need to subtract the size of this thing. So that's this, which means I need like a move size right here. So I'm subtracting move size. And then I'm storing that so that I don't compute it twice. All right, what else do we got? Oh, gotta recompute the sizes of the chunks because size one has just decreased by the move size, and size two has just increased by the move size. So the total size hasn't changed at all by that operation. It's just I move stuff from one chunk to the other. And the other one will be quite similar. We'll have a move size, but that's actually going to be the start minus the size one, right? And that's how much we're moving in this case. And we're actually moving from data plus all this, so the end of the buffer there to here, so after the into the gap pl and that's it, like that's the whole thing, right? There's our destination in this case, there's the source and the move size, yes, and then we just need to invert who gets the plus and who gets the minus. That maybe does the move, hopefully. And the next thing we need is to actually put in the new text. And I've just had another idea that we'll want to handle after we do this. Let me just check something real quick. I'm gonna just pop this on because it's starting to dim outside and I don't want to end up in incognito, so there we go. All right, so now we need to put some text into the gap. To do that, I have the string and the length, so the gap's just sort of sitting there. I think it's just good to go. And we know that it's big enough because we checked that up top. So we're just going to mem copy into the data, because now we kind of know that they don't overlap, because it's required that the string you pass in is a different, is not overlapping at all with, is not a part of the buffer. I require that from outside. So the data plus buffer size one, that's the beginning of the gap. The string that I'm putting in place, and the length of that string. And now this is only ever doing inserts though, right? We haven't actually talked about, we talked about moving things to the right location, but I haven't actually talked about what I need to do to delete what's in the range, right? That's a part of this whole deal, right? Because I have to delete what's in this range too, and right now I'm just making sure that I can do an operation by putting the gap in the right spot, but then I'm just always inserting this without deleting this, and that'll be a problem. So before this actually happens, I need to delete that. And what that basically means is the size one is very easy. It becomes start, right? Whatever start is, that's where your size one goes. And now size two has to be updated as well as the gap. And the answer to that is a little maybe harder, maybe. Well, I know how much the gap is going to increase by when I do the delete. The gap is going to increase by End minus start, right? However much I'm taking out, that's how much the gap increases by. And that means that size 2 is just the whole size, which still shouldn't have changed. No, wait. Oh, wait, right. So that is the max. Minus these other two. Now that's probably not the best way to do it, but it's the first thing that comes to mind. Maybe a better way would be to say that we're going to, like, this is how much we're putting in the gap. We could maybe to figure out how much the size 2 needs to shrink, because size 1 and size 2 are only shrinking right now. They might stay the same or shrink, that is. But they're strictly not growing while I delete text. So size 2 maybe I could compute it by saying subtract out a certain amount, which would be, how much is that? That's however much I'm taking out, which is n minus start, minus the difference between this before and after I set it. That's not a good way to do it. There's also, before I set that, I could look at how far over size 1 I am. That's a pretty good way to do it. So I'm thinking, take end minus buffer size 1. That's how much comes off the right-hand side of the gap. And then what goes into the left-hand side of the left-hand side of the gap just becomes the size of whatever start is, right? Start is telling you where your left-hand gap, what its size winds up being. And then the gap size is increased by that amount because those variables haven't changed. So that looks like a better way to do it. And then we can do the insert, no problem, of the text. And so basically, this code here mirrors this code here, which is shifting everything out of the way. Instead of shifting stuff, I just have to move, which is much better. The only time, once in a while, I guess all of this also mirrors that, which is getting all of the text in the right position so that you can fit something in place is kind of what that does. This maybe right here is more about what this is doing here. And then, of course, what we could do, just to be really slick, is we can do an assert that after we've done that, size 1 plus size 2 is exactly equal to the size plus the shift amount, right? So that we make sure we've done everything right on both of those. And we could also test that. Oh, because after I insert this, after I do the mem copy, I need to increase size 1 by len. That'll be important. Which suggests that what I actually want to do is put start here and just totally skip this and set this to that later, right? That looks pretty nice. It's about as good as it's going to get because you got to update all of the sizes to do everything. So that's moving sizes around to simultaneously remove something and put this in its place. And then, yeah, okay, cool. Or what I could do is do the text replace first and then all of that falls out like so. Maybe, yeah, okay, that's the way it should go. That's pretty good. And afterwards, I just want to do the asserts that make sure that everything still adds up. Because those two have to always equal the size, but so do these two. And these plus the gap has to always equal the max. So I can assert those. I always like it when an algorithm or a structure or something has like some sort of universal law that you can just say this should always be true. So once you're done with operations, assert those things. And if they aren't, then you just catch bugs for free. Self-testing. Very cool. All right, so that kind of is a buffer replace range for the gap buffer. Let's see. I can't believe it compiled first time. Did it? Did I not turn this one on? No, it's on. So this is the one that's running. I wrote good code. So at least compile time code, it works. Let's take a look at the file view though, because there's plenty of stuff to actually make this happen still. So doing a single edit, for example, we now need to tell it about that. And here's an interesting problem. File grow as needed. This was something else I was thinking about, and I said I was thinking about it, but I wanted to finish the other train of thought first. Is that growing isn't as simple anymore because growing now is more like, oh hey, the mem copy of the old data to the new place just isn't good enough anymore. What we actually need is more like, and I'm wondering, yeah, it's more like a thing that puts the two chunks. I'm wondering how I want to do that, because I have reallocate, which is nice to have, and maybe I just reallocate the chunk still, and then I mem move everything over. The only downside to that is when the reallocate doesn't, when the reallocate doesn't manage to, keep the memory in place and it has to go find a new chunk, in the bubble system, when it has to get a bigger bubble from somewhere else, it does a whole copy, so I'll end up copying the second chunk twice. Whereas if I just get an empty chunk, I can guarantee I copy once, I just don't get reallocated anymore. Not sure. I'm gonna go with the second option for now, because it's more general, I think. I think it gets harder and harder, maybe, as I go to other types. Like, gap buffer is pretty similar to a golden array in a lot of ways, so a lot of the abstractions are just gonna work out for free. But if I'm going to do this the way I've been doing everything else, is what I need to introduce is a function that takes in, the buffer and a new chunk with a new max and recomputes the state of the buffer from there. And I think that's a pretty good memory independent way to handle all of the buffer types. Like, even if I'm doing ropes where I have a bunch of small strings, I still just want that buffer to be one concise allocated block, and I'll just sort of have a sub allocator will be a part of the ropes, which would be crazy and nuts, but that's the way it'll be. Yeah, so I think that's what I want to work on. Now, so what I need is kind of like initialize, but not quite in an initialize. It's more like a relocate, and it takes in the buffer, and it takes in new data and the new max. Right, something like that, and it says that it wants to. Is that how you spell relocate? That feels wrong. Relocate. That's right. Oh well. What can you do? Whoever invented that word spelled it wrong initially, I guess. Although that's how I typed it when I first put it in. I don't know. I don't know. Maybe they're right. So to do this, I need mem copy the old data into the new data with this much, right? And then we'll probably want to return this so that it can be freed, and we'll say after that the buffer's data equals the new data, and the buffer's max equals the new max. And for the golden array, that's really just about all that it cares about. Yeah. Okay, and then similarly, if I come over here to this one, who's also got to an initialize function, I can give it a relocate, and relocate a gap buffer. What I want to do is look at my new data. Also, these should all like assert that the new max is greater than or equal to the buffer size, you know? A lot of empty space in there. I don't like that. Let me fix it real quick. There we go. That's better. So buffer size. So the new max needs to at least be able to contain this buffer. Void. There we go. And here's the result for later. Now, to do these mem copies, here's the new data. Here's the original data, and I want to do a mem copy of size 1, and I want to do a mem copy of size 2, which will start at buffer size 1 plus buffer gap size, right? So that'll get the part, and it'll go to... Now this is where I need to know the new gap size already, right? So I need like a situation where I have new gap size, and new gap size needs to be computed up here, which is basically the new max minus the actual size of the buffer. And so we can just do that. New data. And I'm trying to figure out how I want to organize this stuff. Well, no matter. I'll get back to it later. New gap size. And of course, there's no such thing as max here. Wait, there is. What am I talking about? But there's no such thing as not having gap size set, so I need to set that. New gap size. So we'll set those three. We'll mem copy the two chunks into the new buffer. New gap size. Plus size 1, I think. Right? Because we also want... not to write over that, right, so that pushes all the way to the end. That's the amount, size 1 plus gap size 1 plus the new gap size. Okay, that makes sense. And let's see, so here we're asserting that we can do this. We'll separate you out. That's fine. It's always a little bit of a mystery to me how I want to put new lines in, or it's occasionally a mystery to me where I want to put in new lines, so that I can move around quickly to important parts, but also so that I don't have to take a long time to move through a bunch of spots. Let's see, I probably want to separate these, I think. That's so many gaps now, so the question is, what do I sacrifice? And I think the answer is this one. All right. Cool. So, I just got a cool idea. It'll be really nice once you've got code analysis working. That'd be really cool. The trick with this is I don't know how much of my code analysis stuff will be super useful, because you gotta switch between modes to get the code information, like, in there. So, yeah, I don't know. I can't wait to get to the high-level stuff again and actually see how things start to shake out. That's an interesting choice on spacing. Anyway, I'm gonna leave that so I don't get too hung up on moving everybody's spaces around. And now we can go back to the file view. And the question here was, now that I've got that, can I do grow as needed in a better way? And the answer is that what I'm gonna have to do is right here, store the old data, like so. I can't do a realloc anymore, so I'm really just asking for a request size and telling it what type it is. That's fine. Memory allocate. If we got the new data, then go on. I'm not sure that that's the right way to do that actually, because I'm not never asserting this outside, because I don't want to assert that something is like on something that I need to happen. I don't want to assert on an expression that I want to keep in release. So, I should just assert that for now. And maybe someday in the future, so I'll make that tentative, that will change. Now, the trick will be I don't do any of that. That's now replaced with buffer relocate, right? Which takes in the file buffer. And it takes in the new data and the max size. And then after that, I need to do free on the old data. Although I have it returning from here, which maybe isn't necessary now, but I'm gonna say maybe it is, because then I don't even have. Okay, so the nicest thing about this is I don't even have to tie myself down to any particular, like, name for the data pointer, right? Which maybe is nice, because maybe I want to have some flexibility there, as I was saying, for the ropes or something, right? So this returns what needs to be freed. It's a single pointer, so you can only free one thing. But, you know, maybe that's all you need to free. And file grow is needed. Anything else that needs to change about that? Well, we have this concept of max is still exposed right here. But that seems a lot better. I'm gonna leave it at that. And see if there's anything else I need to do to make this work. Oh, you know what I never did today? I normally do, is put my little card right here so I don't accidentally edit code in the invisible zone, in the unseen section. Right. Now I've got my calculator on my mouse. Okay. Boom. Back to it. Buffer relocate. You've got some kind of problem with my buffer relocate. Can't convert from void star to char star. Right. That's fine. I can retype that for you so that you won't have to panic. It will all be good. Okay. So, I'm not sure that this should actually work. We'll see. All right, that's like more than I expected to see. I expected it to not even like be enabled properly yet, but we're actually getting to the point where it tries to replace a range in the gap buffer, but it's saying, oh, that okay, right. So start and end can be less than or equal to each other, Alan. Less than or equal to. Way to go on that one. All right. And I should also do the same thing in the golden array because I almost certainly made the same mistake. There we go. That's a bit more solid, hopefully, in terms of not screwing up the assert. All right, got another one. So it's saying that the new size doesn't match between the two different things that add up to the new size. So who is wrong and who is right? Well, the original size was 120,992, and the shift amount is 1. Right, we're inserting one thing, so that should grow by 1. Right, so size plus that should we should get 102,993 when they come together, but it sounds like size 1 plus size 2 don't agree on that. They only say 160, which is kind of crazy. So start is 159 plus length, which is 160. How did you... Oh, that doesn't make any sense. This is bogus. This should be... Oh, so this should be size minus the end, right? That's what that should be. That would make more sense. 286. So let me get up the gap buffer, go to 286, and that should be size minus end, right? Right, we haven't adjusted the size yet, we haven't adjusted end, so yes, that's what it should be. A. Alright, now what is it? Why is it broken still? Okay, here we are. It's the same one. Wait, no, it can't be the same one. Those add up now, right? Those add up. Size 1 plus size 2 should... Oh, wait, I just typed in the number. What is size? Okay, size is... Okay. Is it breaking on the second one? I didn't check. It might be. So let's take a look at the second one and see if it's adding up. So there's that. And here is size 1 plus gap size plus size 2. Those don't add up. Okay, good. So there's our problem. I think I'm miscomputing gap size, because this should also... The gap size should literally just be the inverse of shift amount, right? That would make sense, because this is one bigger than it should be. And if this was the inverse of shift amount, this should have shrunk by one. And the other thing is, this is assuming I'm just doing a delete, but I'm doing a delete and an insert, and I haven't told it how much I'm inserting yet, so that needs to decrease by the length that is being inserted. And since I have shift amount, why don't I just use that? That will be even better. Haha! I can insert characters into my gap buffer now. Can't backspace yet. Or delete. Or delete range. I wonder if I can copy paste. I kinda can. Not really, but kinda. It's got a little problem with the stringify, for sure. Yeah, it's not totally broken, though. I can replace that correctly. So, the fact that the backspace and delete aren't working doesn't mean that deleting text out of the gap buffer is broken. Right, and I can just sort of go and go. So, look at that. I can type in the gap buffer. Let's look into a few of these things. So, I want to start with backspace, because that's the first one I found. That'll be in here. Backspace. Okay, so some of these are just being removed by the scalpel. So we can actually maybe look at them in the editor first. So backspace works now. What about delete? Delete works now. So you can go. Who else is on the scalpel? Case change range. Right, that's fine. That should be under the scalpel. That should be That should be all this token stuff still should be, but deleting a chunk should not be under the scalpel. So it can go. Cut should not be under the scalpel, so it can go. Seek white or token left. That's a token related thing, so it should be. Token thing. That's exporting, which is pretty complicated. Why would that not be allowed? That should be allowed. Token thing. This should be allowed now. Alright. Got a little damage in there. Alright, so deleting the range isn't totally airtight, but it can be pretty easily made to airtight, because I think it's just a matter of using the size interface correctly. While I'm looking at that, I don't like any of this, how this is laid out, so let's fix that. Why would I have assert size if size is... Alright, so don't delete something if size is not positive. And don't delete something if your cursor position is already at size. Sure. Same thing going on down here. Is this needs to be updated to using the size interface? Like so. Not sure why I was converting that size to I32. It's kind of unusual. Wonder why I would have had to do that. Alright. So let's see. Can I delete this comment? Looks like I can. Alright. And now the other cool thing is we know where the gap is. The gap is right here. Right? So I can do all sorts. Well, actually, what I would be really good to do maybe is do a quick pause and look into the state of this and make sure that that's true. So, a good general pause location is right after I got the vars. No, that's appinit. More down than that. Right after I got the vars in the step. Okay. Let's take a look at the vars. There's a lot of stuff in there. I want to look at the working set, so we can pull that down. I want to look at the files, so we can pull that down, and I want to look at the second file, because the first one is a special file that is kind of just a thing about how stuff works in 4coder. So, yeah, so the buffer is the gap buffer. Most of the size of the buffer is on the right hand side, but some of it's on the left. That's neat. It's good looking. It's cool. And if I were to take this variable, I'd love to look at the gap directly and see for myself, once and for all, a confirmation from the debugger that it's doing what I think it's doing. And I would like to keep this round as well, so that I can look at the sizes. So the whole buffer is 262144. That'll give me the whole thing, which is what I need to do in order to see everything. Now, the gap starts at 752. So, If I can get there in some way, if I use the scrolling there, that's too fast. That got me pretty close though. Then I can hold this hopefully. There's no great way to move around in here. $7.52. So that right there is where the gap starts, in theory. Platform independent. So there's the comment that I deleted. It's just sort of sitting there. It looks like everything else is right here too, which is unusual. If I go to the very, like, somewhere random in the middle. No. Alright, there we go. So there, I'm finding a gap, which is not really where I'd like to see the gap. But then on the other end, I do see my bottom comment. Another good reason for having a bottom comment, people. And that suggests that there is a gap. It just might be that I copied the whole buffer in at one point. And so that's a bunch of like garbage, like that's the, or you know, this was originally split in a different position. It was split right in the middle. So that's all the just the junk left over from when the split was at a different location. I'll betcha. Well, it still goes pretty close to the size of the whole buffer. Not sure why that would be. It is less than the size of the buffer. You can see it doesn't actually get all the way down to bottom. So it did split me initially. Oh, wait, we're not even done. I'll bet you that I initially copy the whole thing in and then move the other end when I'm first initializing. And that's why we see the whole thing in place right there at the beginning. There it is. Yeah, so you can see it looks like the whole thing is right here. So to just make absolutely sure that it's working over the gap, I want to take a look at when it's initializing. Initialize. You provide the data and it does a convert in. It does that, and then I'd like to just do a quick mem set on this, and this will be like probably even more temporary than this, just to make sure. I just want to make sure that it's actually doing the right thing, and it isn't like just having to piggyback off of broken code that works as long as the buffer has the whole file, so that somehow seems possible. So, although it might not be possible, because I mean it didn't show the characters there, like after I deleted them. Alright, let me do another quick pause. No. Okay, stop, stop. Why is this file edited, first of all? Okay, and again. What is this camel case that I'm using? It looks like it maybe wants to stop at the end of words. I should rethink that a little bit because I don't really think that's any use. That's not really of much use just stopping there. I should also stop at the end of a word. That might be more useful. But anyway, let me just put in this little message. And now I'll turn on this stop. Here is the buffer. It probably has the same max, it does. And here we go. Oh, by the way, one other question for you, buffer. What is size 1? 1866. Okay. I was hoping it'd be a little easier to reach with this if I picked a different number. It was a little bigger, which looks like it was. 1866. Asdiff jiggle. I don't see the results of a clear zero like I would like to see. Then again, there's still the fact that I did move stuff there, so let me move down farther to like halfway. Yeah, I'm not seeing the results of a mem clear like I want to. Wait, no, I'm not even halfway yet. There it is. There it is. So there we go. Okay. Yeah, I was shifting the bit the decimal digits. I was shifting the digits in my head the wrong way. I thought that was a 100,000 position, but that's 10,000s. So yeah, it looks like we got a clear zero there, and we're rendering over that just fine. So that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. If we can do single replaces, and they're basically working, let me test a few other features real quick, like copying and pasting. There was a bug with that when I first tried it. So we'll take a look at how that goes. First of all, can I delete a range? Yeah, that works fine. Can't undo yet, but there's no reason I can't put that in soon. Copy, paste. Yeah, so that's totally bogus. That just copied something from the middle of nowhere. Okay, so the stringify there is a little busted. What if I copy that? Yeah, it's just copying from somewhere else in the buffer completely. So we aren't. Copy is not working. Let's take a look at the copy command. There it is. Okay. Let me know when you see a copy. Ready? Copy. What's going on in here? So, well, first of all, you're referencing the data of the buffer, so that's a red flag right there, right? That's just not right. And then you're copying. Yeah. Okay, so you know what happened here, folks, is I just haven't rewritten this to use the stringification interface. So let's do that. Okay. And the interface for stringification, get that up. Stringify loop. Next, oh wait, no, that's under abstract because they're all the same when they stringify. Stringify, stringify. There it is. Right, so I have to provide the start and end location that I want to stringify, which is basically in this range, which is great, and an out a buffer out that contains that much space. Now the thing that sucks a little bit, well, yeah, the thing that sucks out just a little tiny bit is that I'm about to copy this data a second time into the clipboard using clipboard copy. So maybe it's time to revisit that and see if I can't prevent myself from doubling up on something. Where is that? That's probably stored under file view, right? Yes, so the way I actually want that to work is gonna be different. Working set, this provides the data. The size comes from the range. It does the post clipboard here. Next clipboard string. Right, so what I really want to do, actually, is more of a... Well, this is going to reduce down to, like, nothing, isn't it? Because I'm going to do this, and then... Okay, so basically this function just doesn't exist anymore. Because the copy wants to happen out here. It's actually the copy that I need to move out. So you can go away. Or I'll do this in case I want to reference anything. I don't think I should want to. But anyway, what's going to actually happen is we're going to say get the next clipboard string. For that, I need mem general. I need the working set, and I need the size, which is range end minus range start. I need a destination to store that into, and then after that, I want to do my stringify, which involves taking file buffer and saying here, put in everything from range start to range end. And I think actually the string goes last. I have to check that interface again, but something like that. Stringify and then post to the clipboard the new. Alright, so that looks fine, except maybe the buffer stringify, but it looks like that worked. And the only issue now is that cut needs to be told not to use this. Not to use this no longer existing function. So this is pretty much the same stuff. Other than that, we want a new string for storing the copy. We stringify into that string. We post to the clipboard. Yes. So really, I can pull this out into a new function. It's just going to have a different signature. The signature is going to be, come over here. The clipboard copy needs general memory, yes. It needs the working set, yes. It needs the range over which the thing is happening, yes. And the buffer out of which the copy comes. Or better yet, I'll just pass in the editing file. That way I don't have to use a buffer name there. Type name for the buffer will just be sort of hidden away. And then I can grab all of this. And voila. I have myself a new clipboard copy function. Working range end minus range start gives me the destination string. Stringify into the buffer, whatever type that is, doesn't matter. I never had to type its type name. And it'll match by the magic that I've set up with the preprocessor. So the start and the end are still the same, the destination string, and then I post to the system clipboard. And so now, whenever I want to clipboard copy, I just say, here's mem general, here's the working set, here's the relevant range, and here's the file. Okay, so I'm still not getting what I'd like to see. Namely, I'm not getting anything pasted. So it's possible that the copy is still messed up. So I'll trigger a copy and we'll watch what happens. Comes in here, says what's the range that we're talking about? Okay, it's positive, so this has a memory size of 7, which is good. That seems fair. And it's going to try to stringify that, and I suspect that the stringify just totally doesn't work. Or it does, and the size of the string maybe never gets up incremented. Yeah, so I need to tell the size of the string to get set to that. Working set next clipboard string maybe should set that. Or, well, the technically right thing would be not to do. Okay, so let me go to file view. Destination string size equals this. It's not a member of string, huh? Okay, just size, gotcha. No. There it is. All right, so that is much better. And the rolling paste works as well. So it looks like basic text editing just happens now. And the cool thing is the gap only gets moved. It doesn't move the like every time I move the cursor around. So if you're cursor dancing like I do, it doesn't move the gap around all the time. Now that is peculiar, don't you think? When I seek up, it skips that first one. What is that? It's skipping that one. That might be an issue with the placement of the gap. We might have an actual gap bug now, finally. I've been waiting to see it, because I'm sure there's an off by one error, like, because I just haven't been able to find this, and now we've got this bug. So this is a rare opportunity to see this bug in its natural habitat, doing what it does, screwing something up. So I want to make sure to stomp it out now while I have it. You are all kind of old breakpoints at this point. Let me see. I want abstract up right there. All right, here we go. I'm gonna seek up to the next empty line, and we're gonna watch it skip over that spot, which I bet has something to do with the gap being in an awkward position. Maybe it's because I'm not doing greater than or equal to n there, which maybe I'm supposed to. There's always a little confusing about what should be inclusive and what should be exclusive in this system. Because, like, if the absolute position isn't inclusive, then this minus here doesn't work out, which is how I kind of want that to work. Which means I kind of always have to do this. Maybe I could say absolute position minus 1 whenever I'm setting end, and then do greater than like I'm used to. But greater than or equal to is probably the right best way to do that. And then is position inclusive or not, which it should be, because I usually want to test position if I'm there already. But that's a little confusing too, because now you have two inclusive ends on this one, and you have an inclusive exclusive when you're going forward. But let's take a look at what exactly happens. So for this situation, I like to have loop data up there, plus position, and I'd also like to have loop data plus no. What else am I gonna wanna see? Well, yeah, show me loop data plus the absolute, or minus the absolute, no, plus the absolute position. Okay. Now let's take a look once I have everything set up right. So the absolute position is 324. My position is 544. So that means that's the position of the gap, right? That should be where the gap is. Let me take a quick peek at the buffer. How do you spell buffer? And 324, absolute position, 324. Okay, so that makes sense. That means we basically have a chunk of the buffer. The size is all funky. That's not very good. The absolute position, the size isn't actually being used. The absolute position tells me that I'm there, I'm separated, so that makes sense. The data starts at right after the separation, which is where that double new line happens, which is what I'm going to be seeking to. All right, so position greater than 324. So I think right now what the problem is. Is that this is not being treated inclusively, and it should be. That's the number one problem causing this bug. I also suspect that I want my position here to be treated inclusively. So I should go make that change while I'm here and see if we don't get better results. So, to do that, let me first visit Golden Array and see how it's doing the backify. What is your rule for backify? I give you a start position. You're saying start can be equal to the size. I'm not so sure I'm feeling that anymore. Now, the disadvantage to making this inclusive. Well. If these are implemented exclusively, then the easy thing to do is just increment start. That way I can implement it as an exclusive, which is what I want to do on this side. But I so that sort of like relieves the pressure. It relieves the pressure between the two sides where the outside wants inclusive, what the inside wants. Exclusive. So, pop over to the gap buffer. Backify. Plus plus start. So that just all in one fixes that. And then let me pop over to abstract, where I have a few backify loops that probably were hastily put together without me considering the fact that I want to go greater than or equal to end. Well, do I? Here's the trick about that, is if I go greater than or equal to end, then it's possible for position to get to negative one, right, if I'm seeking backwards. So it's a little bit tricky. I want to be greater than end when end is the actual size of the whole thing. But I want to be greater than or equal to end if the end is including a character on this chunk from the stream. So the nice thing to do would be to say the end No, I'll just do it this way and then say that I have to deal with the case where position goes to zero. I could also say that I just and right here, I guess. Right? That wouldn't totally kill everything. So this one looks like it's already based on greater than or equal to end, which is good. This is greater than or equal to end. So it might really be just, oh, here's one that's not. So that wants to be greater than or equal to end and greater than zero. Okay. Yeah, so that feels like it's gotta be working because that's where the gap is, if I'm not mistaken. And we're hitting it now, so that's good. Alright, let me see how much time I'm at. It's been about 2 hours, so I think I'm gonna call it a day. We got editing in the gap buffer done, and we got to do a little debugging, figuring out how I'm going to actually get the streams, the Backify streams, to work. It looks like that's looking better, and I got the cursor seeking, or the not cursor seeking. I got the camel case seeking working again. So that's a pretty productive day, I think, of streams. So thank you everyone for coming out. Make sure to pay attention. Sometime in the next couple days, I'll probably release a new 4coder demo that has the auto tabbing in it. Also, there'll probably be a bonus stream again this weekend. Look out for that. Thanks again, and see you later.